Hi, my name is Eric Messimore. I'm a physician, pharmacologist, and university professor, and I believe in moving useful mental health information out of libraries and textbooks and into the hands of people who are most likely to benefit from it. And today I'm going to be talking about an interesting compound, a natural substance called acetylcarnitine, and I will be presenting information about its potential usefulness as a treatment for depression. So let's start by looking at some reasons why we want to look at things other than standard antidepressant medications for a talk like this. First, depressive disorders are extremely common. Not only are they common, but they are painful to endure. They can be disabling, they can diminish life quality, and they're associated with increased risk of suicide. So altogether bad. We do have a variety of medications that can be useful, but they're useful in 50% to maybe 60% of people who take them. In other words, around half of people who take antidepressant medications don't really get much of a good response from them. And amongst people who do respond, and even amongst people who don't, side effects are a problem. They're a problem for every form of treatment. Side effects to antidepressant medications can be deal breakers, or they can be long-term nuisances that will eventually cause a person to want to stop taking them. And then that person is maybe back to where they started. So side effects are a limiting factor. It's also great if we can find antidepressant substances that affect brain chemistry in ways that are different than the ways the traditional medications affect brain chemistry. Most of the antidepressant treatments that we have are designed to, one way or another, augment the signal of a neurotransmitter called serotonin. Other antidepressants can augment the signal of norepinephrine and a little bit augmenting the signal of dopamine. Those are just three neurotransmitters amongst hundreds of chemical signaling molecules that the brain uses. So in an ideal world, we could find substances that can augment other sorts of brain chemical signals that can translate into antidepressant benefit. And as you'll see, acetylcarnitine probably can do that. Certainly doesn't recreate the mechanisms of action of other antidepressant drugs. And there is just also a large segment of the population doesn't want to take pharmaceutical medications or would love to take a natural or dietary product if such a product is viable, if it has reasonable evidence to suggest that it could be useful. And all of these things bring us to the topic of today's talk, acetylcarnitine, or if you call it acetyl-L-carnitine or ALC. I'll use maybe all forms of these words interchangeably. Acetylcarnitine is a natural substance. It's made in the body. It's widely distributed in the body. There's tons of it, well, figuratively tons of it, floating around, helping to assist energy metabolism. That's its major primary goal. There are, I will tell you later on, about a dozen, actually more than a dozen, clinical trials that show that acetylcarnitine can reduce depressive symptoms. Many of those clinical studies are run against placebos. Many of those clinical studies are simply acetylcarnitine versus placebo. Lots of the studies show benefit. There are some limitations in that these dozen or so clinical studies are run by single investigators at single sites. They're relatively small patient enrollment, but again, there's a dozen of them. So acetylcarnitine is natural. It does have clinical studies to support antidepressant benefit. And the reason that you haven't heard about a dozen studies of acetylcarnitine showing antidepressant benefit is because as a natural product, it's impossible to patent. And without being able to patent something, then there's no incentive for a pharmaceutical company or for me, Eric Messimore, or anybody to spend the money and the time, and we're talking about millions of dollars and many years of complicated effort, to go through the hoops that have been set up to get FDA approval. Back to what is acetylcarnitine? Acetylcarnitine is an acetyl derivative of carnitine. So let's start with carnitine over here. Carnitine is technically an amino acid. So there's your amino group. There's your acid group. Acetylcarnitine is carnitine with an acetyl group. So here we see the acetyl group. Acetyl group is simply an organization of atoms, two carbon atoms and one oxygen atom in this configuration. This is a carbon atom. That spot here represents a carbon atom. That's what an acetyl group is, and you see the acetyl group now is attached to the carnitine molecule. So acetylcarnitine is the acetyl derivative of carnitine. If the body were an economy, then acetyl groups are like the nickels or the dollars in that economy. They are basic units of currency in energy metabolism, primarily in the metabolism of energy from fats. So in this diagram, we're looking at the top. We're looking at a fatty acid called palmitic acid. So all of this stuff is palmitic acid, and there's the acid group. When the body wants to burn a fatty acid for energy, it attaches it to this thing called coenzyme A, CoA for short, and that's what you get. So all of this is palmityl CoA, which is CoA attached to a fatty acid called palmitic acid. You can't burn that. You can't generate energy from that. What you need to do if you're a body and you want to generate energy, or technically if you're a cell and need to generate energy from fat, is that you'll undergo a process called beta oxidation. And beta oxidation happens to cut out two carbon units, acetyl groups, from a long chain of carbons of fatty acid. This acetyl group is attached to CoA because the fatty acid started off as attached to CoA, and that's what you've got. Now you have that nickel or that dollar, that basic unit of energy metabolism, and you can burn that in the mitochondria to generate cellular energy. Problem is that this thing, acetyl-CoA, it needs to get inside the mitochondrion, and it's too big to do that. So that's where carnitine and acetylcarnitine come in. Here's how it fits into the picture of energy metabolism. Acetylcarnitine is generated. Let me get my pen here again. Acetylcarnitine is generated, and that can enter into the mitochondrion where it is detached to carnitine, which can then exit and go pick up more acetyl groups from fatty acid metabolism. That acetyl-CoA that's formed from acetylcarnitine can now enter this thing here called the TCA, the tricarboxylic acid cycle, more popularly known as the Krebs cycle. That's where the mitochondrion generates a ton of cellular energy in a form of a molecule called ATP. Some byproducts or spin-offs from the Krebs cycle that acetyl-CoA from acetylcarnitine feeds into is this pathway, alpha-ketoglutarate, which leads to glutamate, glycine, and GABA. These are important neurotransmitter molecules, and notably, indirectly but notably, you can wind up generating acetylcholine, which is another neurotransmitter. Great. That's what acetylcarnitine does, and how it fits into energy metabolism, and how it relates to maybe augmenting some neurotransmitter output. Here's what we knew about acetylcarnitine in the 1980s and 1990s. We knew that in addition to feeding mitochondria acetyl groups for energy production, it could improve overall energy metabolism and energy function. It could help to burn fatty acids more efficiently, so it would improve fatty acid utilization, improve mitochondrial energy production. Animal studies showed it increased acetylcholine levels, and animal studies from the 1990s showed that it increased a thing called nerve growth factor. Nerve growth factor was fascinating to people who were in Alzheimer's disease research, because in Alzheimer's disease, you lose acetylcholine, and nerve growth factor is a way to preserve cells that make acetylcholine. So given this information in the 1990s, clinical scientists began to test acetyl L-carnitine as a treatment for Alzheimer's disease. Didn't work as an Alzheimer's treatment, but what they found was very interesting. they found that it improved mood and it improved energy. So the patients that were undergoing Alzheimer's disease trials with acetylcarnitine were reporting to the study doctors that their mood was good and they had good energy. They felt that they could concentrate better. And that led to a lot of studies, in fact, according to this meta-analysis, a dozen studies, 12 randomized clinical control trials, including 11 studies in which acetylcarnitine was the only thing, monotherapy. It was acetylcarnitine versus placebo. Total in this meta-analysis that was published by Nicola Veronese and colleagues in 2018, in this meta-analysis, they analyzed 12 studies, total of 791 participants. Crucial thing to mention, the mean age was 54 years old, which means that a bunch of people were over 54 years old. The bulk of the data were done on people that were of advanced age. And here, let me walk you through the statistic. Pooled data across 9 randomized controlled trials, which entailed 231 patients on acetylcarnitine versus 216 on placebo, found SMD, standardized mean difference, which is a thing, another way of saying effect size, of 1.1. For reference, the effect size of amphetamine to treat ADHD is about 1. So the point of all this emphasis is that a standardized mean difference of 1 is huge. 12 randomized controlled trials is a lot of clinical studies. Regrettably, they were done by single investigators usually and involving relatively smaller numbers of patients per study, but a dozen studies with a consistent signal for benefit resulting in this standardized mean difference is a big deal. Also, kind of as expected, with acetylcarnitine being something naturally already in the body, is that in these trials of antidepressant, in the trials in which acetylcarnitine was tested against antidepressants, acetylcarnitine had a lower side effect risk. So, big news that most people haven't heard about. Speaking of side effects, I mentioned earlier that acetylcarnitine was studied as a treatment for Alzheimer's disease. So the Cochrane group decided to look at all the studies of acetylcarnitine for the treatment of Alzheimer's disease. They found a good number, 16 studies that they deemed high quality. They analyzed in these studies a total of 1,500 participants that were given acetylcarnitine. And in the words of the Cochrane reviewers, a variety of adverse events were reported, but there were no statistically significant differences between treated and placebo groups. Don't get the idea that it's completely safe, because nothing is completely safe. Everything has risks. I want to talk to you about these papers, which have some concerning titles. Mania associated with self-prescribed acetylcarnitine in man with type 1 bipolar disorder. Acetylcarnitine and new onset psychosis during the COVID-19 pandemic, and psychosis precipitated by acetylcarnitine in a patient with bipolar disorder. As I said, everything comes with some risks, and just because something is natural doesn't mean that it is risk-free. Everything has risk. Acetylcarnitine has some risks, much less, it appears, than standard antidepressant medications. But typical of antidepressant medications, you see mania and psychosis in people with bipolar disorder. So to me, these reports of mania or psychosis in people with bipolar disorder strongly underline the hypothesis that acetylcarnitine is genuinely an antidepressant, because antidepressants are known to have this side effect of inducing mania or psychosis amongst people with bipolar disorder. So although nothing is completely safe, the side effect profile that we see here in this slide supports the data from like this slide that shows that acetylcarnitine seems to have some benefit as an antidepressant. And then to conclude some tour of data, we have this paper also recently published by Carla Naska and colleagues. Fascinating data here. They looked at individuals with major depression and they measured acetylcarnitine levels in the blood as well as carnitine levels in the blood. What they found was that in people with major depressive disorder, acetylcarnitine levels were lower than in people that didn't have major depressive disorder. And to my mind, fascinating and important is that acetylcarnitine levels were decreased, but carnitine levels were not. So this is appears to be a very specific deficit. And to make things more interesting, in this NASCA study, the deficits of acetylcarnitine were bigger in people that had more severe depression, earlier onset of depression, treatment-resistant depression, which is another way, I guess, of saying more severe depression, and people with early life trauma or neglect. Altogether, the fact that you see deficits in acetylcarnitine in people with more severe depression is consistent with the idea that acetylcarnitine has an antidepressant effect. So, to my way of reading data, I think this is all extremely interesting and makes me both excited and sad. Why excited? Because it seems like we are honing in on, like, kind of like the holy grail psychiatry, a natural product with relatively low side effect risk that is truly helpful for people with depression. Very exciting stuff. Why am I sad or a little bit salty? Because we've known about these benefits or potential benefits from the early 1990s. And here we are 20 years later or so, with hardly anybody knowing about this. We have multiple lines of evidence that suggest that this looks like an antidepressant. To be clear, the data are supportive of antidepressant effects in people that are 50 years old or more. We simply don't have that much data to answer the question of, is it going to be useful for somebody who is like a teenager or a young adult with the first episode of depression? Not a whole lot of data to guide that answer. We do know that it looks like it's better tolerated than antidepressant medications. And we also know that it's not a neurotransmitter receptor stimulator or inhibitor. We know that it's not a inhibitor of neurotransmitter reuptake like Prozac or Zoloft or Paxil. We know that it's not a stimulator or a blocker of any kind of traditional neurotransmitter receptor. So this is working by some different mechanism. Suffice it to say, it's not like anything else that's being used to treat depression. So that's a good thing. But why can we not figure out a way to do the kinds of studies that needed to be done to get the kind of approval that we require of pharmaceuticals so that psychiatrists like me can confidently recommend it or confidently not recommend it, one way or the other, to patients that have need? I mean, we simply, although the data are very promising, they are not up to conventional, currently agreed upon modern standards of quality. And that's a big impediment. So here we have the dilemma of lots of studies look very promising, of a drug that looks relatively safe and not really a way to get it further into practice or make a definitive judgment one way or the other. I wish I could leave you with some more happy news, but take that what you will. And I hope this has been interesting and helpful for your thinking about depression, natural products, and the dilemmas with drug approval processes that we've set up for ourselves these days. Take care until next time.